choose to see this world as a definition of life. I choose to see these trees as a definition of life. I choose to see this road as a definition of life. I choose to see these mountains as a definition of life. I choose to see this planet as a definition of life. I've been perceiving everything as a definition of death. Now I'm giving perception a different purpose. I'm choosing to perceive it as a definition of life. There's a very big cut and dry difference between those who believe that nature is making us, shaping, developing, and making our identity, and those who believe that nature is an attempt to undo our identity. All right, so I'm in the latter camp. I believe that nature is actually a futile attempt to undo our identity. So there is a complete gulf between those two positions, and those who believe that nature is shaping what we are, developing what we are, their identity is a product of nature, they feel very insecure about this position because it's a false position. So they will offer compromises and say, well, nature is, God plants the seed and nature develops and nurtures the seed. As if this is all God's plan to develop an identity, but God starts it out, gives it the start, and then nature comes in. As if this is a co-creation between God and nature. Again, I see that nature is an attempt to undo what we are, that God created us perfect, flawless, eternal life with no need to be nurtured or developed to become what we are. Therefore, this compromise is simply just a restatement of the position that nature is nurturing us and developing us. We're a product of nature, where we're not at all. So it's not really a compromise at all. It's not. So it's either one or the other. Either this is an attempt, 100% attempt to undo what we are, or it isn't. I say nature is 100% attempt to undo, unmake what we are. That's how I see it. So there is this division. I mean, the idea that there isn't some division between belief is nonsense. There is a cut and dried, black and white, total difference of perspective on this entire situation. So that's the first step to point out, is first be aware that there is this gigantic difference, so to speak. Take a little break here. So the difference there is one that people need to decide which way is they believe is true. Can't be both. Cannot be both. Because I say again, nature is literally the attempt of spirit to undo itself, to change what it is. To change its identity, not to develop its identity, to change its identity. That's all the nature is. So it's either that or it isn't that, something else. It can't be a high compromise of that position, because that position is adamant. It's 100%. And most compromised positions say, well, there's a cooperation going. It's part this and it's part that, and it's complicated, and we, you know, and this. No, it's not complicated. It's not complicated at all. So obviously, those who believe in one way have a focus, certain focus. Others who believe the other way have a different focus, absolutely different focus. My focus is on giving a different purpose to perception, and that is to. The things that we have used to try to define us, to undo what we are, by first presenting a definition, then having that definition die, or be redefined, actually, is what happens. Instead of that, we give the purpose of perception to, for that, for instance, that tree, to define life for us, to be defining life for us. That tree is now defining life. That is defining life, meaning that there is light around the tree. There is the feeling of life around on the edges of everything, as if it's melting into the undefined living light. Now, we are told that perception literally can be given a different purpose and can be given this purpose. Right now, we are believing that nature is nurturing us, okay, and that somehow, but we don't, what's happening is nature is nurturing our desire to die. That's what nature is nurturing. But that's not nurturing our identity. It's nurturing the vain hope, wish to have a new identity, a different identity. But it can never succeed at that. Whereas choosing a different purpose, then nature is nurturing us to get past the continuity issue that we have. Meaning we're used to defining definitions. We need to let go of all definitions, but we need to have a smooth transition into that so nature can nurture that transition, the preparation. Where now, it says, I used to see this sign as my death. This sign used to be a definition of death for me, but now I choose to see this sign as a definition of life for me. See, so that is the declaration. I used to perceive this tree as a definition of death. Now I perceive this tree as a definition of life. So you can say anywhere you go, you can make this declaration. And we will try that out. Let's try that out. I used to see this tree as a definition of death. I now see this tree as a definition of life. I used to see this plant as a definition of death. Now I perceive this plant as a definition of life. I used to see this plant as a definition of death, and now I see this plant as a definition of life. I used to see this dirt as a definition of death, and now I see this dirt as a definition of life. I used to see the cinder block wall as a definition of death. Now this cinder block wall is defining life for me. This orange used to be a definition of death for me. Now I perceive this orange as a definition of life for me. These flowers used to be defining death for me. Now these flowers are defining life for me. This sky used to define death for me. Now the sky is defining life for me. My perception of this flower used to define death for me. Now my perception of this flower defines life for me. This stone used to define death for me. Now this stone defines life for me. These flower petals now define life for me. I used to see this water as defining death for me. Now I see this water as defining life for me. So there you have it. You can use this, I used to, or you can, the short form is just, this water, my perception of this water is now a definition of life. My perception of this sign is now a definition of life. This sign is now defining life for me. This car is now defining life for me. So everything you see, this car is now defining life for me. This juice is now defining life for me. Everything. Don't leave anything out and don't dwell on anything specifically. Don't say, well, this person is now defining life for me. And that's a special. Nothing, no specialness. In the change of perception. No exclusions, no specialness. Very important. That's why we cannot have a quote-unquote special relationship, meaning this, whatever this is defining life for me, but the rest of the stuff isn't. That's not a change in perception. The change in perception is total. It means everything you see is now defining life. For me. Everything I see is defining life for me. This, that, these stones are now defining life for me. are now a definition of life for me. Those stones are defining life. That plant is defining life now. It's now defining life. It's now a definition of life. That tree is now a definition of life. So, I tried this and it's very powerful. Very, very powerful. And I will include a clip at the end of this video where I first began trying this new declaration out, that it has so much power to it. This is the path that I've been on, and it's different than other paths. It seems to be. I cannot find other paths that seem to correlate exactly with this, really. But this is what has been indicated, certainly in A Course in Miracles, is change your perception. Give perception, your perception, a different purpose. And we can do that. We can do that. We can literally perceive everything now giving us a definition of life. That water is now giving me a definition of life. Those stones are now giving me a definition of life. That concrete over there, that concrete wall, is now giving me a definition of life. That wall is now defining life. Is now life-defining instead of death-defining. That tree is now life-defining. This sky is now life-defining. That mountain over there is now life-defining, defining life. It's definite, giving that mountain is now giving a definition of life. I perceive a definition of life there. So I'm looking to settle into the right declaration, and you can work with it. You have to work with it to see what feels best for you. But it's very important to continue this time declarations, because we're in a situation where we keep trying to manipulate our environment. What we do is we believe that what we are, our identity, is being shaped by nature. So we want to do things to nature so that nature shapes us even better. So we want to manipulate our environment so then our environment then nurtures our development better. So that is the direction the world has gone in. It's the wrong direction. It doesn't end well at all. It doesn't go along well at all. The right way is to, whatever you see, don't manipulate it. You see a tree, let the tree be there, and say, I used to perceive that tree as a definition of my death, but now I perceive that tree as a definition of my life, of life. I used to see that tree as a definition of death, I now see that tree as a definition of life. So this is what we can do as we go along. I now see that tree as a definition of life. And so by making these declarations, our expectations are aligned properly, and we start to believe that, yes, we can. We can change our perception. We can give our perception a different purpose. Don't try and manipulate external things. That's the mistake. That's the mistake. That's why, let's say you went to like a very advanced spiritual community, if there was such a thing. You might find them living in caves. You might find them living very simple lives. And you just think, my God, these are primitives. They're not trying to manipulate their environment at all. They seem to be doing the absolute minimum. A little bit of water, a little bit of food, and that's it. And you think, wow, those poor people, I really need to help them, help them out. No, because what they do is they will sit and they will gaze and they will say, what I'm seeing now, my perception is now seeing me, definitions of life. Everywhere I go, I'm seeing nothing but definitions of life. This little twig is now giving me a definition of life. This little stone is now giving me a definition of life. This plant is now giving me a definition of life. My changed perception is now giving this pathway a definition of life. My changed perception is now giving that rock formation over there a definition of life. And so they are literally surrounded by definitions of life. Wherever they look, their perception shows them a definition of life. They see edges of light, rays of light, edges of light everywhere. Everything they look at is giving them a definition of life. And so they just sit there, they drink a little water, eat a little food, walk quietly, sit quietly, work on this declarations, work on allowing this perceptual change of purpose to take place. And they realize they don't have to manipulate anything. Ramana Maharshi said, instead of trying to rid the world of thorns and pebbles and stickers and such, just wear a pair of shoes. Problem solved. That's what he's talking about. Change your perception. You don't have to manipulate your environment, because you're doing that to try and nurture the growth of an identity. Whereas if you change your perception, everything is giving a definition of life. And that reminds you of what you are, that you are life. That life is life. It doesn't need to be nurtured by something. Life was created life. It was not created incomplete. It did not need a process to complete it. So these declarations are important. Try to do it as you move around, as you're driving. Say, that car is giving me a definition of life. That car is now defining life. That car is now defining life. That road is now defining life. I see a definition of life in that road now. I see a definition of life in that sign. That sign is now a definition of life. That stone is now a definition of life. Those houses are now definitions of life. So everything is now a definition of life. Keep declaring that. Keep expecting it. Keep building your graciousness towards that, so that you can graciously entertain the change perception when it comes, when it arrives, as it most certainly will. This plant is now defining life for me. It's giving a definition of life. This plant is now giving a definition of life. So this is very advanced, but we have to jump into the advanced stuff right now, given the situation we're in the world. We need to, absolutely need to. Because we're being told that what we are is a product of nature. That's what we're being told, and we're being forced into that, to accept this dictate. Even though it's completely false. I choose to see this weather station as a definition of life. I choose to see this as a definition of life. I choose to see this as a definition of life.
I choose to see this blossom as a definition of life. I choose to see this ant as a definition of life.
I choose to see these flowers as a definition of life.
I choose to see these flowers as a definition of life.
I choose to see these leaves as a definition of life. I choose to see these boards as a definition of life.
I choose to see these oranges as definition of life.
I choose to see this weed as a definition of life. I choose to see these stones, these pebbles, as definition of life. I choose to see this leaf as a definition of life. I choose to see these stickers as a definition of life.
I choose to see this flower as a definition of life. I choose to see this stump as a definition of life. I choose to see these branches as a definition of life. I choose to see these leaves as a definition of life.
I choose to see this sunflower as a definition of life.
I choose to see this grape as a definition of life. I choose to see this concrete as a definition of life.
I choose to see these flowers as a definition of life. I choose to see these palm leaves as a definition of life. I choose to see this flower as a definition of life. I choose to see this cobweb as a definition of life.
I choose to see this flower as a definition of life. I choose to see this flower as a definition of life. I choose to see the sky as a definition of life. I choose to see this plant as a definition of life. I choose to see this flower as a definition of life. I choose to see this greenery as a definition of life. I choose to see this flower as a definition of life. I choose to see these flowers as definitions of life. I choose to see this flower as a definition of life.
I choose to see these weeds as definition of life.
I choose to see these leaves as definition of life.
I choose to see this twig as definition of life. I choose to see this leaf as definition of life. I choose to see this trash as definitions of life.
I choose to see these old flowers as definition of life. choose to see these cobwebs as definition of life. I choose to see these flowers as defining life, as giving a definition of life. I choose to see these flowers as giving a definition of life.
I choose to see this fruit as giving a definition of life. I choose to see these ants as giving a definition of life. I choose to see these fruits as giving a definition of life.
I choose to see this tree as giving a definition of life.
I choose to see these leaves as giving a definition of life. I choose to see this ivy as giving a definition of life. I choose to see this stone as giving a definition of life. I choose to see this leaf as giving a definition of life. I choose to see this fruit as giving a definition of life.
I choose to see this plant as giving a definition of life.
I choose to see this bee as giving a definition of life. I choose to see this plant as giving a definition of life. I choose to give these little stones. I choose to see that these stones are giving me a definition of life. I choose to see this bug is giving me a definition of life.
I choose to see these chimes giving me a definition of life. I choose to see this display giving me a definition of life. I choose to have these old leaves and decay and cobwebs give me a definition of life. I choose to have these leaves give me a definition of life. I choose to have this spider give me a definition of life. I choose to have this leaf give me a definition of life.
Hey, I just saw something really important, and that is, the world is backing itself into a corner, and it's going to claim, once it gets into a corner, it's going to claim that you put it there. You're to blame for putting it there. It's backing itself into a corner. And then once, what happens when someone gets backed into a corner, they become irrational, they realize, oh my gosh, I'm cornered, I'm going to fight my way out now. They're going to see you as standing in front of them, and they're going to say, you put me in the corner, even though they're trying to help. You're saying, hey brother, you know, let's all go down the river, there's a man, you know, walking on the water. Come along with me. I want to see that man walking on the water. And you're there saying, hey, I can help you walk on the water. And all the while, they're getting more and more backed into a corner, backing themselves into a corner purposely. And you're there trying to help, and then they look at you and say, hey, I'm in a corner. You're in front of me. You put me in this corner. I'm going to get out of this corner. I'm going through you. That is the problem. Just saw that. I said, holy cow. I'm looking at the news, and I say, these people are painting themselves into a corner. I'm not doing anything. We're not doing anything. No one's pressuring them. They're doing it to themselves. They're doing it to themselves, but they're not going to blame themselves, are they? They're not going to take responsibility for it. So I said, uh-oh. This puts a whole new perspective on things. You may not want to be trying to help them at some point. You know, like a drowning person, they try to help them, they pull you under. And you wonder if them getting in this terrible drowning situation wasn't just a setup to grab you and pull you under. Say, help, and then pull you under. I'm seeing the world painting itself into a corner. Everything that the people are saying now, I just say, my gosh, you're pinning yourself down. At some point, you're going to look around and you're going to feel like you got no options. And then you're going to insist that you didn't do that to yourself, that someone did it to you. And that's where you're going to be come out swinging. That's why, again, I'm preaching the relocation thing. Let's all go down the river. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man walking on the water. Come along with me. I want to see this man walking on the water. Jesus is the man at the river, and he's washing all your sins away. He can make the dumb talk. He can make the lame walk. He can make the lame walk and open up the eyes of the blind. He can make the lame. I don't have that chord there. It doesn't really matter, because the point is, we don't have to have everything lined up perfectly in order to make wise decisions. We don't have to know every chord in the song to sing the song, right? We know the song. He can make the lame walk, he can make the dumb talk, and open up the eyes of the blind. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man walking on the water. So what does that mean? There's a man walking on the water. There's a man that's not sinking down into the world. There's a man that refuses to be pulled down into the blame, to be blamed for the sins of the world. The world wants a scapegoat. The world wants a scapegoat. The world is painting itself into a corner and then wants to a scapegoat for that. They refuse to acknowledge. The mind refuses to say, no, I didn't do that. I didn't do that to myself. Someone did that to me. There's some force doing it to me. No, the mind is doing it to itself. The mind is putting itself in a corner. It's putting itself in a pickle. And then it's going to come out saying, hey, there's something did this to me. Something did this to me. No, the mind did it to itself. Come along with me. I want to see that man walking on the water. I want to see that it's possible not to walk, not to get pulled down, not to get blamed. You see, they wanted to use Jesus as a scapegoat. They said, you're the perfect scapegoat because you're trying to help us. You're to blame. See, Jesus said, I've come to help you. I've come to liberate you from delusion. And the mind said, wait a minute, you're the one who has put us in this terrible situation. So if we just get rid of you, we're saved. You see? didn't work, did it? Doesn't work. So we cannot allow ourselves to be crucified by what the world's doing. More and more, just seeing the world, wow. They're tying themselves up into knots. They're heaping all this stuff on themselves, bringing themselves down. And they're going to look then and say, hey, who brought me down? And I'd say, you brought yourself down. I said, oh, no, we didn't bring ourselves down. You brought us down. I said, no, I've been trying to help you. So it's a dangerous game that they're playing. Come along with me. I want to see this man walking on the water. So at some point soon, we're going to have to get wise and say, wait a minute. This is a scam. This is a game that's being run on us. This is the mind running its game. It's the mind that's running this game. And you get this feeling saying, oh, wait a minute. It kind of feels like, you know, they're looking to pin blame on someone. Their own folly, their own mistakes. They're looking to pin blame. And I'm saying, huh. Who's in the crosshairs? Who's starting to? I'm starting to feel like this general sense of being in the crosshairs. Many people are, and we better wise up to it quickly. We better start walking on the water. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man walking on the water. Come along with me. I want to see this man walking on the water. Yeah, he can raise the dead from the grave, change the water and turn it into wine. He can make the lame walk, he can make the dumb talk. Record that dumb talk, and open up the eyes of the blind. But what if the blind don't want to have their eyes open? What if the blind are saying, you made me blind. You're responsible. I can't see because you blinded me. It's like people are putting their eyes out, you know, and they're screaming, I'm blind. Someone blinded me. They're inflicting all this stuff on themselves and then saying that you did it to me. Someone did it. I know somebody did it. And of course, the mind will recommend the scapegoat to them. The mind is doing it to itself and then recommending a scapegoat and saying, you know, I know who did this. It's Jesus who did it. and Jesus and his cohorts, they did it. Gotta go after them. Go after them and your sight will be restored to you as long as you punish those who did that to you. It's like everybody saying, I can't see. Who put the hood over me? I can't see. They put the hood on themselves. They got this hood and they're putting it on themselves. They can't see. And they're running around screaming, I can't see. And then you put the hood on me. I know somebody put the hood on me. Who was it? Gotcha. You know, gotcha. That's what's happening. That's why I have this uneasy feeling. I got this stressed out feeling, uneasy feeling. And if we just need to start naming it, what's happening? The scapegoating, the blame game is going on. People are throwing hoods over their heads and then insisting they can't see and then someone else is to blame for that not being able to see. Or they can't see because they're choosing not to. It's scary. I'm getting too scared by the news now. I see that look at the news. Holy cow, the world has truly gone into the abyss. It's a mania. You want to talk about mania? Look at Brazil right now. As I've said this week, did I not say that this week it's all going to start? You're gonna start feeling it. You're gonna start feeling it. What happens is people get into this blinded state, and others get see that and say, wow, what's this game? And they jump into the game, and more jump in, and more jump in. And before too long, they all got hoods over their heads, and they're screaming, like, wow, I can't see, I'm so oppressed, I'm just so, you know, this is so terrible, what's going on? And someone says, why didn't you take the hood off? He said, what are you talking about? You're oppressing me, you know. And then before you know it, the mood builds and builds and builds, and it turns into hysteria. And they start looking, hunting for the oppressor. And then you start making concessions, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Because they're still blinded. And it's a game, it's a dangerous game that the mind is playing right now. The mind is playing a very dangerous game in the world right now. And better wake up and see it. Better wake up and see it before it's too late. There's this uneasy feeling right now. So, wait a minute. Don't you have this feeling like, oh, wait a minute. It feels like there's this game going on. There's some kind of strange game going on in the world. Oh, wait a minute. You say, like, is that possible? Like, is that possible? Is what I think possible, possible? Is that it? And then you say, nah, not possible. Come on. And then you get a more uneasy feeling. You say, well, maybe it is. Maybe not. Nah. That can't happen, can it? It's happened many times. And sleeping, maybe not sleeping so good. Feeling stressed out. Feeling this vague sense of, like, Something ain't right in the world. Something ain't right. I just, the faucet started dripping in the kitchen. And last night your pitcher fell down from the wall. Today a man called me. Said he'd take all my things away if I haven't paid my bills by 10. Things have gone to pieces since you left me. Nothing turns out half right. Now it seems. Nothing feels right now, it seems. Nothing feels right now, it seems. Nothing feels right in the world, does it? Nothing feels right. That's the thing. Is that true? Nothing feels quite right now. And there's a feeling like I can't quite make it right. The more I try to make it right, the more I say, whoa, I'm getting pulled into something here. Getting pulled into something. And you want to say, whoa. It's called the guilt game. Let me tell you what it's called, is the guilt game. They're doubling down on guilt. They want to blame you for their problems. You're responsible for their problems. You're responsible. Therefore, they have the right to attack you. It's the guilt thing. So the game, the mind is playing a guilt game at this time. It's playing a very severe guilt game. And you want to help, but they're not interested in being helped. They're interested in projecting the failure of what they're trying to do, which is trying to unmake what they are. They're projecting that failure upon you, upon those who try to help them. They say, you're the reason why I cannot unmake what I am. Because you're telling me, no. You accept what you are and say, no, I've got to unmake what I am. There's two directions to go. One is to insist that we are a product of the world. We're a product of nature. That nature is creating us. That nature is nurturing us, is growing us. Where identity is something that's being grown. The other is to say that nature is an attempt to unmake what we are. That what God created is complete and whole and perfect, and we are trying to unmake what we are. And we've made this device we call nature that supposedly has some capacity to erode and change, unmake what we are. And that's what's really going on. The good news is that we cannot unmake what we are. However, would you tell people who are trying to unmake what they are, who believe that what's really taking place is they're growing an identity in the world, and you tell, and then they keep trying to unmake what they are, unmake and put themselves in worse and worse and worse and worse situations, and you keep trying to help them and say, no, just accept yourself as you are. They'll say, what are you talking about? You're the one who's preventing me from becoming what I can become. So you see, it's set up for scapegoating and blame. It's set up for you to be blamed, saying, you're the reason why I'm unable to complete this unmaking of myself and become a new self, because you're still hanging on to that old, old, old time religion. I'll just love. I just love that good old country preaching. This old world has gone without it much too long. I just love that good old country preaching. I just love that good old time religion. I just love that good old time religion. The people in the world now don't love that good old time religion. They believe they're on the cusp of being fully born through the crucible of existence and nature, that nature is about to birth them, and they don't want to hear any of that old-time religion. They want to get rid of that old-time religion. They say that's the reason why they've not yet been born, is because the old-time religion is telling them, no, that you, God created you perfect, and your spirit, God created spirit, and those who love the things of the world, God is not in them. They love the things that deteriorate, the things of the flesh, deteriorate, fall apart, and die. And those who love that impermanence, they don't love God. They don't love God, and they need to repent. The people of the world are in no mood to repent right now. What they're in the mood for is to scapegoat. Okay, this is one of the basic messages that I've been giving out. They're in the mood to scapegoat. That's not a good mood to be in for anybody. I just love good old gospel singing. I'll Fly Away is my favorite song. Good old country preaching. Oh, this old world's beyond without it much too long. And we're in a situation now where you can feel the mood is either the mood is one of repentance or it's one of scapegoating in this world. I'll tell you that. There's nothing else. It's either a mood of repentance or scapegoating. Not a mood. A compromise is not a mood. Compromise is a delaying tactic for those who want to scapegoat. Those who repent are not in a mood of compromising. Repentance is not compromise. It's saying, you know what, God? I ask the mind to present this simulation, this training exercise, to try and teach me how to undo what you created. And I repent from that. I change my mind about this. I'm telling the mind to give that idea up. Here's a new idea for mind to accept what I am, accept accept myself as I was created, which is spirit and truth. That's repentance. There's no compromise there. You don't say, well, God, you planted the seed, but nature's done the nurturing. That's a compromise. That's a position that's still denying that the authorship of God. It's saying, well, no, you started things, God, but it's me that finished it. It's nature that finished it. You know, I'm the one who really did the job. You know, you didn't do it. You maybe got the ball rolling, but I'm the one who really finished the job, so to speak. So there's no repentance there. So either the world's in a mood of repentance or a mood of scapegoating. One or the other. One or the other. So what is the mood of the world? What is the mood of the world? The sun comes up to greet the dawn, as usual. I awake to find you gone. Gone, as usual. You cannot hit those, when you're quiet like whispering, you cannot hit those. You have no range in your voice. I can't be shouting and hollering because I'm outside the neighbors, etc. So, gotta be sotto voce, as they say. So, the sun comes up to greet the dawn as usual, you know. I awake and find you gone as usual. We awake every day in this world to find an unrepentant attitude, to find a lack of ourselves. Where's ourself? Where's God? Where's the self that God created? We don't see it in the world. Where is it? There's all this impermanence in the world. Where is the self that God created? It seems to be gone. We think, God, you're hiding it from us. You're hiding it from us. But what we're really saying is, we wake up to greet the dawn, and as usual, we haven't yet succeeded in unmaking ourselves. We haven't succeeded yet. Dying to what we are. When we look at the world, it seems we're gone. I awake to find you're gone as usual. But as I sit here telling lies, the tears, they start to stream from my eyes. I guess you'll always be gone to me as usual. We're so sad. We get up every morning, we see that I find myself gone. I look at the world, I can't find myself. And the tears start to fill my eyes. I feel like I'll never find myself. It's gone. It's gone. What I am is gone. It's lost forever. Because the mind is showing us the simulation of loss. Of loss. Simulation of definition. And the redefining, which we define as loss. And so all we're seeing is loss, really. We look out and we realize everything we're seeing is going to be lost to us at some point. And we know it. It's visceral. Not even conceptual, it's visceral, we know it. So we get this feeling of wistful loss, you know. That's where all the sad songs come from. Here I sit on the back row in a church down the street, not too far from the place where we used to meet. So we lament loss. We meant that we feel in a situation of loss. Well, we're watching a movie of loss is what's actually happening. Imagine if you're watching a movie of and it's so sad, and the people in the movie they're searching for love and they think they found it, but it slips through their fingers and they lose it. Everything slips through their fingers and they lose it. And you're crying. So sad to see good love gone bad. Everly Brothers and a million other songs. That's what we're watching this movie, and we got so many tears in our eyes, you know, we can't even see that it's just a movie. we think that we've lost something. We haven't lost ourselves. But we're so used to watching a movie, we're afraid if we stop watching the movie, we won't know who we are. So what we have to do is we have to change the reels in the projection booth and put on a new movie. I've been living a new life that I love so. So put on a new movie on the reel, and that movie shows us something different perception. What it shows us is everything now defines life to us instead of loss. Everything has this definition surrounding it, almost like a halo of life, this haloed light around everything. So everything now defines life to us. We look out there and we say, I see life. I see life. I like this movie. This movie showing me life, not loss. We need to see a new movie. I haven't touched a guitar in 10 years. And my fingers are killing me. The steel strings, tearing my fingers up in my hand and everything. I can hardly press down, so. But it'll come back in a couple weeks. It'll take a couple weeks. It's already getting a little better. But the D chord just, oh man. I stay away from the D chord. those thin steel strings just, slice your fingertips almost. So, but I figured I'd break things up a little bit, change the pace a little bit here, get us in a different mood, put a little twang into it, a little 3D twang into our 5D cup of tea. We don't have to completely, you know, jettison the past and all of that kind of stuff. That's not what it's really about. What it's really about is choosing this new movie to see this light around everything. I choose to see that. I choose that this road defines life. I choose that this road. I see this road as definition of life. I choose that I see this road as a definition of life. See. I choose to see this plant as a definition of life. I choose to see this sky as a definition of life. I choose to see the world as a definition of life, meaning that it's all lighted up with light. It's surrounded by light, as if it's emanating light. I wouldn't say it's necessary. Things are emanating light. But more that they're in the gentle, everlasting arms of light. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, safe and secure from everlasting arms mean this light that is around everything. Everything is bathed gently in this light. And so everything now is defining life for us. As we see everything, say, that defines life for me. That's the definition of life for me. I used to see, you know, I was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet thou art. Save a wretch like me. I once was.
was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. So the blindness is this movie of loss that we're watching. And the seeing, the everlasting arms are, is that everything is bathed in this thin, the edgings, ever the edgings have this beautiful light that is playing. The scintillating, sparkling, beautiful light of life is playing along the edges of everything. Like every, the world is marbled with this exquisitely beautiful light. And so you see, everything's a definition of life now. I used to see this tree as a definition of death and loss. Now I see it as a definition of life, aliveness and life. So who puts the new movie in the movie projector? That's the question, right? It's supposed to be the Holy Spirit. So you need to say to the projectionist, "Hey, projectionist, would you please put in a new movie for me?" So if we can see it this way, you know, we're on the road. We're on the road to salvation. We're on the road to be reminded of life. This, now I see this defined, I choose to see this as a definition of life. I choose to see the world as a definition of life. And only by seeing these fringes of this living light are you reminded of life, because life is a living light. The living light is life. This solar light, this reflected light, it's not the living light. That's a projection, that's a movie, that's a simulation. As we pursue the attempt to unmake ourselves, uncreate ourselves, we cannot uncreate ourselves. We cannot uncreate ourselves. And yet, this simulation, everything here is being, seems to be uncreated. But it's just energy changing form. It's just definitions being constantly redefined. There's nothing that's dying. It's just definitions morphing. There's this mass morphing taking place, really. What you have in this world is just morphing. You might say the whole world, universe is just this vast morphing software program. And everything is this morphing. We feel like this loss, constant loss. Oh, there's something. Oh, it's morphing. It's constantly morphing. The tomato plants are dying out there. They're getting old. Oh, what happened to the green leaves? Oh my gosh, they've turned brown. Well, I wonder how the old folks are at home. Wonder if they miss me while I'm gone. I'm gone. Wonder if they'll cry for the boy who went away, left his dear old parents all alone. People leave their families, you know, they go away. One day they're living with the parents, and the next day, gone. Wonder how the parents feel. Sometimes they're happy. Sometimes they say, well, they feel like they lost something. It's gone away. The leaves have turned brown. As soon as I get my hand and fingers in shape and my thumb and everything, then I'll be able to do something. I just had to get started here. And I don't remember the chords to the songs. I don't even remember the minor, how to go from the
The C, what's minor, what's the minor key in C? I don't even remember that. That's ridiculous. See? It should be A minor. It's A minor. I just have a hard time playing it right now. That's a hard one to play. Just hanging out here in the old good old time gospel hour. Just hanging out, just stop speaking some truth. Just speaking some truth. Important thing is to remember that just, you know, considering truth, it doesn't mean, again, you lose the twang. You don't, everything doesn't get taken away from you, as it were. You don't have to radically remake who, you know, yourself, your personality, anything like that. It's a change of perception that we're aiming for. We're not trying to change our personalities. Not trying to change who we are, that part of it. We are aiming to be reminded of life. We're choosing to see a definition of life. The living light, a definition of life. This car, I choose to see this car as a definition of life. I choose to see this evening as a definition of life. I choose to hear this song as a definition of life. Now, I don't know how it goes with music. Maybe there is this kind of a light around sound. It's a different kind of light than perceptual light, but it's like more like a felt light. So maybe everything you hear has got a sort of a type of light around it. Too. Everything you smell, everything you taste, everything is a reminder of life. Riding a bicycle. You know, you haven't rode a bicycle in 10 years. You get on a bike and you kind of, whoa, what's this? Okay. And, you know, it comes back pretty quickly. Yeah, muted playing. I was just working back at the bridge. Muted. How to mute it. Forgot to remember how to mute. Thing is that you hang out with truth. You don't be in a hurry to grab it.